we don't have a live audience. Hey, welcome to this week's show. My name is Joon.
And I'm Christine, and let's get ready to rock your biz.
Okay, so today's episode is another part of our series, Our Favorite Companies.
Yes.
As you guys know, my favorite company is always Costco, but we're allowed to do one episode on that. Anyway, so this week's episode is one of our favorite companies, the Virgin Empire.
Yes. Sir Richard Branson.
Sir Richard Branson.
My business idol. Probably my number one next to Oprah. It's like tied. Like who would I do have dreams of like meeting each
They're very cool. Hard to beat Sir Richard Branson.
Yes. Yes. Brilliant guy. The thing I love most about him is what he'll do. And this is, you know, he has so many companies he owns.
Cool is just that he's a sir, first of all.
That's he doesn't awesome. Like that, though. He said he doesn't understand awesome. Why, well, why.
It's kind of a stupid thing. Yeah, it's pretty cool.
We call him that, but he's like, whatever. I like that he takes an industry that annoys him and that he's frustrated with, like the airline industry, for example. Mm-hmm. You know, first, obviously, he had his record label. But after that, he started Virgin Airline because he was annoyed with how crappy the airlines were.
Yep.
He's like, you know what? I could do this so much better. And he did.
Yeah. I think that's actually one of his famous quotes is that he says, all entrepreneurs should originally start out of a sense of frustration.
Yes.
That should be the fuel behind it because it's basically trying to create a better mousetrap.
Yeah, exactly. So I think that that's great that he does that. And his company, his brand is so well recognized and he branched off into what, like 200 companies?
No,
now?
I think last time, technically has like 400 companies at one point in time had been under the Virgin Empire.
Nice.
Think about that, 400.
Holy cow.
Now, you've never heard of some of them, or most of them.
Yeah.
I think the average person knows like two or three.
Yeah.
You know, but you love this guy. I mean, I respect it. I have not read as much about him as a person as you have, right? You even sharing us with our viewers, you shared like his exercise tip, right? That every day he
swims 2 to 2.5 hours a day in the ocean, you know, around Necker Island. Because when he was asked, you know, what's the secret to productivity? That's mm-hmm. what he had said. Well, I swim like 2 to 2.5 hours a day. And that's why I'm so productive. I was like, whoa, that's a lot of time. Yeah. But
that's cutting into my sleeping time. 2 to 2.5 hours.
But if it's going to add 5 hours of productivity pushed into, you know, another hour or whatever.
That's pretty cool. Yeah. And obviously, you know, he's what we call like a lifestyle entrepreneur.
Yes.
But the reality is, I mean, he built a huge empire. But the thing is like, you know, if you think of the Virgin Empire, there's not a single company that's the number one in its space. Just think about that. That's like, I think that's more true to like a lifestyle serial entrepreneurship. He wasn't trying to be like the one company that everyone, he has such a diverse interest.
Yeah.
You know, because he's frustrated with all these things. He's like, well, I could do that better. You know, now most of us want to do that. We're just not successful at that.
Exactly right. You know? And yeah, one of my favorite quotes, he says, it's not just work and it's not just play. It's all living. I actually have that. On my wall and mm-hmm. my desk at my office, his quote, because I love that. That's how I feel, like, oh, I put it in the
perfect
word.
He actually likes
work.
Doing business.
Like,
right.
It doesn't feel like work to him because it's like he loves what he does. And that's kind of how I operate.
Yep.
So I'm like, oh, I love that. I mean, that's just why I just idolize him.
Yeah, and that's the thing. I mean, that puts it a lot of perspective. Like, I think for most people when they start up their business, I'm pretty sure most people don't know what they want to be when it grows up.
Yeah.
They don't know, do they want to be a Microsoft or like an IBM HP? Do they want to be a serial business where no one ever really hears about it, right? But if you click enough of those, if you click 400 of them, apparently, you become Sir Richard Branson. You
nice.
Know? But the thing is, you know, he's not number one in each category, but think about it. A lot of the industries he's in, to be top 10 or even top 20, you're making, that's a multi-million dollar company to even be on the radar for that kind of stuff, right? So, you know, his most famous one is obviously Virgin Records. That was like the big thing for him. That was inhabited, I think, top three in its space at any point in time. He got out before, he actually sold it to one of these major media conglomerates. Because what's happening in entertainment is studios that do movies are buying, you know, music and entertainment and video games. They're buying them all together because they realize they can cross-sell their stuff. You know, but that's who he sold Virgin Records to. And he is on record for crying that day. I mean, even though he's a serial entrepreneur, that was his baby because that's how it all started for him.
Yeah, you know? And I think the airline at that point in time was kind of having some troubles.
Yeah, so they were duking it out even legally with British Airways.
Yes.
And he got a huge settlement from them.
Yeah.
Because they had basically hacked his like computers and like were saying lies about him. And
it
all
was a horrible rivalry.
Yeah.
Horrible. If you read the books, yeah.
And it's funny because he was an up-and-comer. they were like the established business, and they just saw him as a threat, so they wanted to bury him because they were afraid of his track record.
And, yeah. Well, what's funny is that, and a lot of people didn't know this, he launched Virgin Airline in 3 months flat.
With one plane.
Launch a whole entire airline with just one plane is, first off, crazy to begin with, but to do it that fast,
right.
within 3 months of, from when he had the idea to when it's like, okay, we're...
And again, we talk about this a lot, like, once you know something's in your wheelhouse, right? So his infrastructure, he probably had a lot of things that he's like, yeah, the only thing I don't have is, like, you know, one gate allocated to me as an airline. Well, that, you can buy your way into that. But all the rest of the infrastructure, the recruiting, hiring the right people, cultural fit. I mean, that guy has a definite cultural feel to his companies.
Yeah.
You know, they're all his personality, right? He's notorious in the business world. He's great because he is obsessed with basically organizations that's being top heavy. He wants the bottom of the organization to be informative and relational and reactive, to be more nimble. That's more of an entrepreneur's kind of game. So no matter how big the organization is, he wants it to be more nimble, to be bottom driven, right? And that's why you reminded me in our pre-show that basically, you know, he had taken Virgin Records public, right? But when you do that, you're not a bottom heavy company at all. Now you're top heavy, answering your shareholders, doing stuff that no one really, I mean, if you're gonna take a company public, you should know what your job is gonna be after that. Your job after that
answering
point
to them.
Is your shareholder meeting, that's it.
You know? Answering to other people, which most
not even
people,
answering to your customers.
Yeah,
you know?
No. And so you become an entrepreneur to call your own shots, but then you go public, and then you have this board. I mean, I'm sure Mark Zuckerberg of Facebook is dealing with the same problem. I think that's why he held.
That
out
was
so
a lot
long.
Of the skepticism too. That when he went public, how is he going to do that?
Yeah,
because he doesn't play well with other people. He's a little socially awkward. You know, how is that going to work as far as a shareholder kind of thing?
Exactly. So and to know that, and I think that he knew that, and I think that's why he stalled out. But yeah. Richard Branson had actually, you know, didn't want to deal with it. He was just like, this isn't for me, and took his own money, had to pay back, you know, the shares that were purchased from, like, friends and families. And you know,
which had gone up in price at that point.
It had gone up in price, and then in order to just get out of it,
because
it just, he's like, this isn't for me. And I just thought that was really, you know, a lot of people wouldn't do that. You know, they wouldn't pay back everybody.
Right. Like, I know, but I think that lets you know, like, a guy like him knows exactly what he wants to do in life and what he doesn't want to do.
Yeah.
Like, what do I want to spend time doing? If I'm going to spend time managing shareholders and I'm not excited about that, you couldn't pay me enough to do that.
Exactly.
So let me buy it all back. So he basically bought his own happiness back, which is pretty cool.
Yeah. You know? And his crazy, like, hot air balloon going around the world.
I think I was looking up on Wikipedia before the show, like, he's tried to attempt, or he holds, like, 5 world records, but he attempts them all the time. Again, that's like, that tells you a lot about his personality. And who likes to work for a guy like that? And it's just, you're like, that's cool. My boss is crazy. You know? If he dies, he's worth like $4 billion. He's like the fourth, you know, wealthiest person in the UK. That guy goes missing. There's all kinds of bad news.
Oh, no. Yeah, but he's just such a risk taker. I mean, all around in his whole entire life and just does crazy stuff. I love that. I love hearing that.
The fact that he has an island. And that I've seen I don't have any pictures of my bathroom. But I've seen pictures of the bathroom on his little island thing. It's like world famous. I'm like, what the heck? Why do I know what his bathroom looks like on his island? Because the island is just so cool, you know?
David Copperfield has like 7 or 8 islands out
there
too, I heard.
They're all like neighbors?
I don't know if he's neighbors with him. I think he's in, I don't know. I think it's a different part. But I just thought that when you get that wealthy, you start buying
islands.
That's
whatever.
So funny.
We don't want houses. We would just want straight up islands.
Yes.
You know, but I would say, you know, for all of us watching this, here's some of the things that in every success story, this is what people get confused about in business, is that even like in entertainment, there's these success stories and everyone thinks it happens overnight. No, you heard about it overnight, but those success stories took a long time to get there, right?
Yes.
So Richard Branson right now is like 60 something years old, something like that. He started his first business when he was 16. Right.
Yeah, the
magazine. Right. And so this is the secret with most entrepreneurs, is that they try a lot of things and they learned a lot of hard lessons along the way early on. You know, so at 16 years old, he started this magazine, and he was at a basement of this church. He's putting out this magazine. In there, he was selling ads for like certain albums and stuff like that. And ends up through that, you know, starts a business selling records, like selling music records. And then through that, ends up getting dinged big time, to the point to which he loses this huge court case, and his mom has to mortgage their house because he still doesn't have a lot of money to his name. She has to, you know, refinance or mortgage their house in order to pay off that settlement fee, right? And then you know that it says something a lot about that guy that he took that defeat and he took the money that his mom had to put up and he said, you know, I'm going to make sure this never happens again. So one is he built up his wealth to pay her back as soon as possible, get that off the books, but that he never made that kind of mistake again.
Oh, yeah, I bet not.
Yeah, you probably don't forget that kind of stuff, you know.
And he suffers, which a lot of, I mean, this is public knowledge and a lot of people already know this, but that he suffers from dyslexia. Mm-hmm. And look how successful, so he's such a great inspiration. I mean, a friend of mine, you know, on Facebook had said, oh my gosh, we just found out my son has dyslexia.
And you're like, and great.
No, I mean,
there's a great role model for him.
Yeah, I said, oh my gosh, you have to read this book by, you know, one of Richard Branson's first books. And you know, it's just so motivating to see that, you know, I think a lot of people have different things they have to overcome. And
everybody does.
Yeah, everybody.
Okay, now here's the thing. Even if you're born with a silver spoon in your mouth, you have to overcome the fact that you're born with a silver spoon in your mouth. You don't have to do. But here's the thing. In the world, there's two kinds of people. There's the kind of people that life just beats them up and they just bitch and whine about everything. Everything is something else's fault. But there's the other kind of person. This is a clear minority of the Earth's population. People that say, you know what? Everyone's dealing with something. And you can't worry about that. But what can you focus on the stuff that you can actually change and control, you know? And it's funny because some people are like they do these research studies psychological kids when they're like in first or second grade. So you're talking like, you know, what, 7, 8 years old. And they can start to tell right off the bat either what kind of parenting or kind of what disposition they have by the way they blame life for at that early age, even. Like they call it the locus of responsibility. The basically is the responsibility on the world to make my life happy, or is the responsibility on me internally to make myself happy? And you can start to see that in kids as early as second grade.
Oh, that's cool.
You know, and so obviously Richard Branson is someone I guarantee you is probably his mom, you know, or his parenting that basically said, you know what, you have dyslexia, so what?
Yeah.
So what? You know, I grew up in an immigrant family. That's the same thing they would say. So what?
Yeah.
You know, well, that's hard. Guess what? We gave up all this stuff to come to this country, and you're gonna complain about that. And I was like, you know, I remember I was sitting there complaining about, like, you know, school exams or something like that. My mom was like, well, yeah, I remember back when I was getting my PhD, you know, I had two kids. I was raising two young kids. I was driving back and forth from Orange County up to L.A. every day when Orange County was just like an orange grove. It was like a dirt lane, you know, road. And she's like, I did that and raised a family. And she finished her undergrad and PhD all like in 5 years.
Dang.
Right? And so here's my brother and I going, we don't have anything to complain about when it comes to school because our mom is like a genius, or she just worked her butt off, right? And so, you know, right now you're watching the show, and again, like Christine, you said, right now every single one of us, if we needed to, could come up with some excuse why today is not going to be a great day for our business.
Yeah.
If you are lacking excuses, I can give you 5 or 10 that you can use. You know, but the whole point is, are you the kind of person that's always going to blame external forces for the lack of your business success, or are you going to say, you know what? Everyone's dealing with some degree of that.
Yeah.
Let's go ahead and make something out of what we have.
Yeah. Know, well, just earlier, I was like, everyone's blaming the president, blaming the government, blaming the economy,
blaming like global warming.
I don't think
pessimism in general, you know, for a lack of business
success. I
really
don't think the president has anything to do directly with your exact business. I'm sorry to tell you, but.
Right. It's always going to be the president. No matter who it is, it's going to be the president that didn't help you with your business.
However great they are. But yeah, it's
but we know our viewers aren't like that.
No. Right? Our viewers are positive and they know it's not what happens to you guys, it's how you react to what happens. So.
And I would say, you know, here's one thing to be careful of. When we look at someone like Richard Branson, we like to think that they're like these crazy home run hitter, super, super scary, extreme risk taker kind of guys. But if you actually sat down with them, he does have filters that he'll take an opportunity and run it through some criteria before. The guy's not an idiot. He's not just going to put money at something that's not going to, you know, has no future in it. So no matter how outrageous or risk-taking someone seems, if they're actually successful in business, that means deep down inside, or maybe secretly on paper somewhere, they have a whole bunch of filters that they're running. That
calculated risk.
Yeah, absolutely. Yes. Now the difference with people that are born entrepreneurial is that we do that instinctively. So like Malcolm Gladwell in his book Blink talks about how people who are born with this, it happens right away, but then you can build computers to do the same thing. It just takes a computer 2 minutes to do what it takes a 30 seconds to do, or 2 seconds, you know? And so he calls it, you know, most people call this intuition, but basically all intuition is, it's a very fine tuned, almost instantaneous way of having all these filters, you know? So the guy's not an idiot. I mean, think about it. He signed in Virgin Records. One of the things that put them on the map was the band, the Sex Pistols. They were controversial, right? But he knew that fit his brand. Like, we are the label that's going to sign edgy music that no one else. So that makes it simple. You're gonna, if you're edgy and controversial and you've got turned down by three major record labels, but you're good enough to get a demo with them, you're our guy, yeah, because that's what our label is, right? He did that. He introduced us to the Culture Club. Just a lot of, I mean, it was easy for him to position. He said, my brand is kind of out there, and that's kind of easy for him to do with his empire, because you can look at his airline, right? This is genius what they do. We're going to talk about Southwest Airlines in another episode because they're a great company, but this is funny. Every time Southwest Airlines offers up a sale, I mean, and so there is someone in Virgin that is on Southwest's email, like, list, yeah, right? I'm telling you, because I'm on both of the lists, within an hour, as soon as Southwest Airlines posts an airline fare, you know, airfare sale, within an hour, Virgin will send out an email with the exact same offer.
Interesting.
Now, the difference is Southwest flies to way more locations than Virgin does,
yeah,
right? But it's interesting that that's all he's doing. I mean, can't any of you guys do that? I mean, if you want to do that, he's obviously doing the pricing game, but basically Southwest is a sale, we're going to do that sale. So pricing is never an issue. And so everyone I know that's flown Southwest and flown Virgin, if everything is equal, you will always fly Virgin. Always. Because it's just cool. You can set up your own playlist. You got this whole entertainment thing to make your flight, you know, super awesome. I think, I don't know if it's live now, but I read about this like last year, was that they were beta testing a chat function where I could like chat you in seat 11D.
Are you
and we
serious?
Got like, chatting and stuff.
Wait.
I just think it's like, that's borderline creepy, but kind of awesome too, especially when you have friends,
yeah,
and you're just chatting with each other, whatever, and you didn't get in the same seats. But I just think it's brilliant
that's
that
funny.
They, you know, and in fact, most of my younger friends, if you ask them, like, okay, how much more would you pay extra to fly Virgin versus Southwest? Like, I don't know, maybe $20. The fact that they would pay even more,
yeah,
even remotely for that experience tells you that his branding is consistent. He's got a certain feel that he wants to his stuff. And for all of you guys that are hung up with like, well, my marketing is not good, whatever, or my brand, what is Virgin's logo?
I mean,
it's a big V. It's scripted in red. It's a circle. Come on, like, how hard is? I mean, that's not, you know, you look at all the world famous logos. They weren't like, I mean, even Apple now is famous. But really, back in the day, you thought for a computer company, a little Apple, really, that's going to be the winning formula for you. Or for Xerox, it's a big X. You know,
yeah,
that's really a good name. That's not a winning name, Xerox,
no,
right? All that kind of stuff. So anyways, like, put a good logo or brand together, but don't get hung up on that kind of stuff.
Yeah.
I don't think Richard Branson spent more than probably 10 minutes thinking about Virgin, and they came up with the name, right, because they all were new to business.
Yeah.
So, like, we should call ourselves Virgin because we don't know what we're doing, right? And I love that he has that mentality for all of his things.
Yeah.
You know, all of his things. What's his newest one? The one I'm excited about is Virgin Fuel. You know? He's just coming up with all these astonishing alternative fuels. And you're like, well, that's very future-minded. I don't know how. I mean, there's a reason, yeah, you're not going against that. The funny thing about it is probably someone as powerful as him is the only person that can pull off something like that, because he's going in the face of the petroleum industry. So if you and I were to do that, we would accidentally have an accident. We would disappear.
Yeah.
You know? But Richard Branson can do it because someone's going to know if someone's
protecting,
kill all that kind of stuff. And then obviously the cool one, this is the one we're all excited about, Virgin
Galactic.
That's right.
I'm excited. I can't wait till commercials, the space travel.
So what is it now?
I'm not on the list right now because it's $200,000.
It's $200,000.
But once it starts coming down,
yeah,
I'll get over.
And what is it?
Lifetime.
How many people at a time are they?
I don't know yet. So the first travel should be soon. I mean, I'm talking,
yeah,
like within a year or 2 years.
Yeah.
For sure.
Now think about this. I guarantee you he had a wait list, right?
Oh, he has a waiting list.
Right?
Oh, for sure. Pre-purchased,
right? So he's probably had that list for maybe 3 years.
Oh, at least.
Right? So, I mean, so say you had 100 people that paid you $200,000 and you had that money for 4 years. I mean, how much interest is that? I mean, even with like bad markets and stuff like that, if you had someone that was a good endowment fund, like, you know, investor, and you had that much money for 3 or 4 years, come on.
Well, the great thing too, and I'm sure you know about Virgin, you know, Unite, right?
Right.
So that's his nonprofit,
yeah,
arm,
yeah,
and he's so giving. And
there's a lot of cool
helps
stuff. Yeah, they do a good job of publicizing, like documenting on their website. It's very clear,
what
like what
do
they're doing. It's,
yep,
pretty awesome.
Yeah. So I think that's another reason why I'm such a big fan, and of Oprah's too. Same thing, you know, that they give back so much.
Mm-hmm.
Is really, really cool.
Yeah, and actually, so, you know, you guys, the premise of my book is that research studies are not conclusive. There's actually 50-50 on, did those people become generous? Like, did they give back because they were successful? Because most psychological studies will show that those people actually became successful because they were always generous.
Yeah.
That basically a lot of people will help them out because they're like, you know what? you're not going to come screw me over. You're a generous person. So I will do whatever I can to help you out.
Yeah.
You know, so for all of you that are struggling in your business, think about this. What are a couple of ways you could be more generous this week? You know, with your business, your connections, or your expertise and that stuff like that. And then, you know, but again, I think the thing that most people don't see with Richard Branson, they see the personality, they see the daredevil stuff.
Yeah.
They see all the, but they don't understand that underneath this guy is this huge iceberg of business excellence. He's got systems and processes. He's got a well-defined infrastructure and wheelhouse. He's got a financial advising department that knows exactly what they're doing when they vet an interest.
Yeah, you know? And if you see him in it, and if you even just go to Google Images and put in Richard Branson, the photos, he's always smiling. He's always having fun. Like, don't you notice every time I see him in media or on TV? Or
no matter what, man. It's borderline hammy cheesy, but it's so consistent that that's who he is.
Like, that's his life. Yeah. He loves his life. He loves what he does.
I've never seen footage of him, like, grabbing a paparazzi and, like...
Or getting mad.
Or something like that, you know?
Yelling.
Probably because I think he has a security perimeter that he travels with at all times. You know,
probably.
Like Oprah. Like, Oprah's not batting down paparazzi. Why? They got a perimeter. She's probably got snipers and stuff that are like taking out people, whatever, you know. But the thing is, he's consistently, he's always wearing like a white shirt, like untucked to the button down. He's like,
chilling.
He's got very consistent branding. Yeah. I love that. He probably looks exactly the same now as he did when he was 16.
Yeah.
You know? And the thing is, here's the thing. There's lots of times in business people say, well, you know, even they say this with Zuckerberg too, like, well, he can't wear his hoodie and go do investor relations. Well, here's the thing. You can either listen to the way everyone else tells you to do business, or you can say, if I'm going to do it my way, I'm going to definitely take some hits. Like, he probably lost some meetings because of the way he dressed when he was younger, right? But the way you compensate that was with a unique strategy and consistent follow-through. Mm-hmm. You know, you can't have your cake and eat it too. You can't say, like, I'm going to do everything different than everyone else, but then not have a system, like a better system and a better strategy.
Yeah.
If you want to be that different, you've got to have a stronger strategy than other people, you know, to do things a different way. Yeah. It's plain and simple.
I just love it. Yeah, when I think of innovating, I think of, he is just the king of innovation. I mean, to say, you know what, like he's shocked, and actually I kind of am too, that we put somebody on the moon and now it's like, why is it this
so many years later,
many years later, and there's no commercial like flights to the space.
One
seriously?
Is, there's nothing to do when you get to the moon. But anyway, other than that, there's not a lot there when you're there. But
that he just, to innovate, he's like, you know what, this is crap. Like, that's
and again,
does.
It's out of his sense of frustration. He's
like,
this is
like
dumb.
I'm annoyed, like, let's do this. Yeah. Like, let's go to space and do commercial flights. And so I think that's really super cool.
Now let me end with a really interesting business fact about Richard Branson. Okay, if this guy were to liquidate all of his withhold, like everything that he owns, mm-hmm. his business structure is such a convoluted web of corporations and overseas companies and all that kind of stuff. He would pay close to zero taxes.
Whoa! How do you know this?
If you liquidate everything.
Is this Wikipedia? How do you know this?
Yeah, it's common knowledge that he set it up this way. Not everyone's been able to track the way it's set up. But you know, if you spend enough time, you can figure it out.
Dang, he had some wizards.
Yeah, so I mean, so that
advisors.
Guy's probably compensated very well, and then probably was somewhere really killed or had a drowning accident off his island or something like that.
Yeah,
but
right.
The thing is, I mean, think about that when it's all said and done, I mean, so again, we're thinking like risk taker, whatever. No, the guy has got some super strong financial savvy behind him in that if he needs to liquidate everything, he's going to pay less than you pay per taxes, you know? And this is a guy with a net worth of like $4.5 billion.
Nice.
You know, so just think about that. There's always a hidden system behind the way people are. People can be eccentric in the like entertainment industry, but people that are eccentric in business, they always have something else going on that no one knows about.
I know, right? Yeah, that's true.
That's the way it is.
That's so, true with a lot of leaders.
Yeah, so hopefully you enjoyed our peek into the life and business of Richard Branson. Again, you know, there's lots of companies we admire, but his Virgin Empire by itself, it's such a unique model because it's not one big business that was like world famous. It's actually a Virgin Empire, which is kind of cool. I don't know if he grew up saying, I want to be an emperor.
Yeah, emperor.
You know, but if it was, man, God bless him, because that's what he did. So hopefully you had a lot of fun learning from the different concepts and strategies and even the personality and leadership structure that he operates his businesses out of. And make sure you opt in our website, yourbizrocks.com, for all the bonus materials.
Yep, and then you can always post questions for us on Facebook, Twitter. You can check us out on Pinterest. We've got the videos up there, too. And join us again next week to rock your biz.
Bye.
Bye. Hey, Christine here with today's Expert Minute, and I wanted to do it on a CD set, actually, instead of a book today. In my, you guys have heard me mention my mobile university. I love to learn in my car if I'm driving around. So this has been an amazing, this was actually just given to me. And I thought, oh, I'll pop it in my car and see what I think. It's the Sales Superstar Program. It's volume one, The Fundamentals of Selling. So it's like a six CD set. Tim Mulcahy, he is actually based out of, he lives actually here locally too in La Jolla, but he's based out of Canada, and he is the CEO of TruStar Nutraceuticals, which is a huge company that's very large in Canada and just now taking off in the United States. And he gives so many amazing tips about sales and kind of the psychology behind sales and how to be successful at it. And what's inspired me, first off, about this book is that he actually started off as vacuum salesperson, selling vacuums door to door. I mean, I don't think sales can get any harder than that, than doing that. For any of you guys out there that maybe did that, or Cutco knives, or any of the other door to door selling, encyclopedias maybe, but that is actually his background. And he just became so good at building relationships when he would come into the homes and talk to them. And that's actually what surprised me, you know, after going through these CDs and learning how important building relationship with your prospect is. So it's not just like, here's our product, you know, pay me this money and we're done and the transaction's done. No, you really need to build a rapport with your prospect, get to know them, find out their pain points, and then, you know, see if what you're offering can possibly help them legitimately. Don't just sell to everyone and anyone. So that was a big surprise, and also, you know, something that now I'm implementing, and now that I'm personally doing differently in my business, as far as just taking the time to make sure that I'm getting to know, you know, how we can help somebody and build that relationship. So again, it is Sales Superstar, the ultimate sales training program. It's a CD set that you can listen to at your home, on your iPod, in your car, and yeah, just take your business to the next level.
Hey, welcome to this week's Viewer Mail, where we get one shot at your most pressing business question.
Yep, one shot.
And Christine, today's we have a special question.
We do.
Because it's from overseas.
Ooh, cool.
Awesome. Kate from Sydney, Australia.
Woo! Nice.
Never been. I think I'll go there next year. Sounds awesome. Oh, this is great. So what should I look for in a franchise or business buying opportunity?
Nice.
Great question, Kate.
This is a very good question. I've actually went this route years ago, which is not smart. Actually, it was smart from a franchisee perspective. When I had my residential cleaning company, I thought it'd be a good idea to do commercial cleaning at night, which is crazy. Didn't know the industry, and so I did purchase a franchise. Mm-hmm. So I've seen that side of it. And I only did it for 8 months, and they actually ended up buying it back from me, so which is good, because that was not for me. I like starting my own businesses. I don't like paying royalties. My biggest advice is a couple things. If you're brand new to business and you're kind of gun shy, mm-hmm. and you don't know where to start, I think a franchise is great, because
right.
it's like a business in a box.
It's like great training wheels.
Yeah, it's yeah. like here you go, here's the marketing, the system.
Do what they tell you to do.
Yeah,
don't try to outthink the
franchise. No, because it's already a proven model. Yeah. So I think it's great for people that are, you know, again, kind of gun shy on starting a business. Definitely talk to other franchisees, make sure they're happy mm-hmm. with that franchise, find out their royalties, because different. You know, yeah. franchises and in the same industry will have different royalty scales, different buy-ins. So you are going to have to
the regional exclusivities and stuff
exactly.
like that.
Exactly, and you will have to put
Subway
money
got
down.
In trouble with that quite a bit.
Oh, they did
just
they?
Letting people open up
right next door to each other. Yeah, oh, that's yeah. awesome. That's yeah. awesome. So yeah, so that would be, you know, my advice is just ask around to friends, you know, to get their opinions, but also the franchisees, just maybe take them out to lunch mm-hmm. of the franchise you're looking at buying into.
Yeah. Now, I'll look at it from the other side. I'll look at it if you're not new to business and you're actually looking at just like from a business like growth opportunity perspective. The number one thing I would look at is how little do I have to operate that
yeah.
in order to actually make money off of it. So right now, if I bought a Subway location, Subway's there's more Subways than McDonald's and Starbucks in the United States. There's more of them located anywhere. So I know that if I personally am there cleaning the toilets, sweeping the floors, making sandwiches part time throughout the week or not, I know that I can personally net probably about $90,000 from that one store location. But I don't want to do any of that. So then the question is, like, okay, if it takes me, like, I don't know, I forgot what the buy-in is for Subway, if it's like 180 or 200,000. For $200,000, how many years of me not working directly in it do I get my return on investment, right? And if I just, you know, and then if I spend my time doing marketing and driving promotions, maybe we can up that up a little bit. Now, if I'm buying a non-franchise, because franchises are pretty simple. The business models are proven, and the royalties are all straightforward, and so that's all documented. So it's really just a math equation. Most people get into it, though, because it's their training wheels. Yeah. They actually want to run a business. And I go, well, I don't want to do that. I'm looking at it from an investor point of view. So same thing with the business I'm going to buy. That's the first question I ask. And we do this for clients. They've had to send me in to either look at a company they're about to purchase and help evaluate that, or get their company ready to sell. And the first thing I ask is like, okay, I'm gonna go through your company, and I'm gonna meet everyone, and I'm gonna fire every single knucklehead I meet, every single person that's not up to snuff to my professional standards. If I got rid of all those people the next day, how much is that company worth? The answer is really troubling for a business you're about to buy, their book of business and the clients. There's all these people that come that you have to inherit them, or else that business is gonna suffer. Sometimes even the owner itself, like, you can't eject the owner out. That's a horrible business opportunity. So, you know, when you're looking at some kind of, I know a lot of people that inherited business, like, you know, some guy, he just thought it was a great business because this woman ran a business for 17 years. He figured it can't be that bad, right? Didn't look at the books that well. This lady worked like 60 hours a week doing it. He didn't want to do that. Ended up being a horrible opportunity for him because he could not put in one of the hours she did, and he wasn't good at what she was good at doing. She was good at networking. And so her operations was horrible, which is why you buy a business for its operation side. But she was out there doing all the business development. You take her out of the picture, sales just plummeted.
Dang.
You know, and of course she pitched it as like, hey, you're smarter than I am. You graduated from college and I didn't. It's exactly what she said. So you could absolutely do what I do. And he's like, oh yeah, I could do that. No good. You know, so I always look at it from, you know, don't think of yourself plugging in and playing in that business. Go, if I needed to remove all of that and automate it and get the right people in there, how much is that franchise or the business opportunity worth with me being a fairly, like, absentee? I'm not in it day to day, but, you know, I'm an active investor, but I'm an absentee worker, so I'm not the frontline worker. What is that business worth? And that should probably weed out a lot of things, Kate.
Yeah.
So hopefully that makes a lot of sense. Kate from Sydney, Australia, hopefully you are starting a trend of a lot more. I know there's folks in Australia, and there's also folks for some reason in Ireland and in the Philippines that actually watch our shows. We can, through some of the correspondence we've gotten. So look forward to hearing from you guys soon. Catch you next week.
Bye.